Hey. So let's see here. First up. Oh yeah. So first I have a poetry sample. Again, for anybody who hasn't gotten the chance to see me do my thing in person. The way that I've described my poetry before as somewhere between like spoken word, hip hop, and like a tinge of Dr. Seuss. I mean that in the best way. And so this is an example that I use because this is one that stays on the top of my head. It has a really bouncy rhyme scheme to it. So it's one that I always remember and I use it to warm up and rehearse a lot. It's called Romantic Rapping for a reason you'll see in just a moment. And so it goes. I heard that it's hard to be romantic when you're rapping, but the truth is you make my happiness happy. But the way we're always laughing when conversing, it's coercing. So I'm switching up my wording while I'm working on my flirting. Because my heart is oddly certain that you're my kind of person and that this rendezvous between us two must be advert. But I feel I don't deserve this. I'm just a wounded-hearted wordsmith looking for someone to nerd with. A couple kisses, a couple hugs, and a whole bunch of encouragement. I've never seen her, but I can't wait to meet her. My Nubian queen or select senorita. I could see the scene, but let me paint it clearer, because I could be the Jean and she could be Melfina. The gracious gravity to hold down this dreamer will explore infinity and not a thing will come between us. Romantic rapping.
I'm muting for that.
Yes, always put your finger snaps up, y'all. That's how we get down over here. And on the next slide, I have actually the lyrics of that poem. And something I like to do with my rhymes when I go through them, especially with one like this, the slide after that takes those lyrics and it has it broken down by the different rhyme schemes that we use. So you'll see highlighted different colors of which words rhyme with one another. Can I get the next slide, Nas? And so, as I mentioned earlier with the bouncy rhyme scheme, and as I'm sure you just heard a moment ago, you'll hear it just kind of bounce naturally from word to word to word to word. I will wear out a rhyme until I cannot come up with another word that makes sense in the scheme. And again, that's something I learned strictly from listening to my favorite hip hop MCs over the years. But this time I wanted to do something a little bit different. I think it's pretty, I don't want to say easy, but pretty apparent to see the parallel between spoken word hip hop, I mean spoken word poetry and hip hop. One is essentially the other without a backbeat. And so while I normally use examples from hip hop in my workshops, like we did with the Midnight Notes, this time I wanted to go and pick songs that were more in the R&B spectrum or more pop, or even a couple of house tracks, just to emphasize the fact that even when it isn't super intricate or layered wordplay and rhyme schemes, it's still heartfelt poetry and some powerful writing. So I know Camille very well. So I know Camille appreciates 90s R&B. And so our first song that we have up is going to be a classic. It's anyone that knows it. So tonight's set list includes this is If You Love Me by Brownstone, released in 1993. Can I get two slides over, Nas? So the hook from there is kind of like the meat and potatoes of the song. But what I love in the beginning, in the pre-chorus, Could I get the song started over and turned down just a little? Is this rhyming device used in the pre-chorus of "You would not hurt my pride if right now you decide"? Because it's the same amount of syllables. We're a haiku association, so we're big on syllable count around here. And so it's cool that the song can ride like that. You would not hurt my pride if right now you decide that you are not ready to settle down. But then it loops back around and does the same thing again with different words. But if you want my heart, then it's time that you start to act like you're mine in the light and the dark. And that last line there at the bottom actually brings together both rhyme schemes from the pair of verses, the pair of bars in the pre-chorus. You're going from pride to decide to your mind. At the same time, you're going from, if you want my heart, then it's time that you start light in the dark. Not to mention, if anybody hasn't listened to Brownstone before, please treat yourself, because like they're harmonies and the way that they play off of each other. There's an acoustic version of this that wasn't on Spotify. I wanted to include it, but it is just as good, if not better, than the fully instrumentalized version. So yeah, that was our first song. Miss 90s R&B aficionado, do you have any take?
Yep, I have a question. I don't know if you know the answer to it, because I know that, like, it's not like you've had, like, formal poetry training per se, but, like, do you remember what that's called? Like, the ending rhymes of, like, I learned this in school, and I can just completely forget. And I think I've been so focused on haiku for so long, which doesn't, I mean, they don't rhyme. So it's like, I forget, like, what that's actually called, like, the rhyme scheme that's, like, it, you know, it's even and it matches a byline, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah, it's definitely something we have to look into, because this is definitely some like really, really efficient writing and some well-written poetry. Yeah. I'm definitely wet beyond the ears in terms of poetry terms too.
You're fine. No, be... I was just curious. It was not a test.
No, you were reminding me that I definitely have more that I need to brush up on. But no, thank you. That's a great point. Also, like, while we're in here, like, and you guys are listening along, please, like, have a pen and pad. If you hear a lyric or read a lyric that really touches you, definitely make sure you write that down. Or if you have a comment, whether you've heard the song before, whether you haven't, whether it's your new favorite or you never want to hear it again, I always like everything that I do in a poetry space to be really top down and free. So please share with me your thoughts as we go along. And if nobody has another thought, we can move to the next tune.
One more thought, sorry, before we move on the topic of rhyming, what do you think rhyming adds to poetry or music, like just lyrics in general, and verses? What do you think rhyming adds to that?
So on a really simple level, rhyming and music as an extension of that, or maybe together, is a memory device. How do we teach kids the alphabet? With the ABC song.
Right.
And anybody who's ever, you know, broken down the ABC song, it's what song in reality? It's Twinkle Twinkle Little Star.
Yeah.
Yep.
It actually took me forever to realize. I was an adult when I realized it.
Oh yeah, nah, that blew my brain wide open when I figured that out. I think I was playing like DDR or something, and they had Twinkle Twinkle Little Star in there. I'm like, wait a minute, this sounds familiar.
That's the most random thing ever. A revelation on Dance Dance Revolution. It's crazy.
Like, you're just mid arrow stepping and you're like, wait a minute, something ain't adding up. But yeah, to that point, or even business and companies that make jingles or TV shows that have theme songs, those things exist because they're gonna drill their way into our head, and we'll hold on to them for years to come. I know people of a certain generation, at least if you grew up in this area, if you were used to watching TV, you had the freaking 800-588-2300 Empire today. Like, that's, I can't even explain to you what Empire as a business is, but I know the jingle.
I'll never forget it. I don't think anyone will.
JG Wentworth 877 cash now. Like, there's so many people's phone numbers I don't know, but I could call JG Wentworth like this if I needed to. So yes, rhyme and music are wonderful memory devices. And speaking of wonderful memories, I'm staying in a 90s bag to start, and we're going with the song from the Goofy movie soundtrack of all things. Just a small aside, Goofy movie was like warm and fuzzy nostalgic childhood movie for me and my siblings. We wore that VHS tape into the ground, and it features a fictional musician called Powerline, who's played by real life 90s superstar Tevin Campbell. And it's playing, so I'll let Nas turn it up a little bit, and we'll listen to it through the first chorus. Lyrics on screen, of course. So the song Eye to Eye, it's spelled that way. And I had this revelation actually while I was putting this together. The whole idea of the song is about two people that care about each other but may have some personal differences or just different ways that they operate or see the world. And that has at some point created some kind of contention or a gap in their relationship. And so as the chorus says, if we look, well, first off, this is beautiful. If we listen to each other's heart, we'll find we're never too far apart, and maybe love is the reason why. For the first time ever, I'm seeing things eye to eye. They went off. And I'm just now noticing with the title of the song, it's Eye to Eye, individual to individual. And it's all about destroying this notion. They really did not have to go that hard on a Disney soundtrack. We'll have to do a dissertation about Phil Collins' Tarzan at some point. Because Disney in the 90s was on a run. And yeah, just that idea, like eye to eye meeting on a level that we can see each other, but also losing that idea of us being individuals on the other sides of whatever it is that we're going through. That's some damn poetry right there, y'all. I don't even write things like that half the time. So, also, just if you need a feel good 90s kick drum pop song to just get you going and put a smile on your face, like this joint does not fail. So, I've known this song basically my entire life, and it kind of just gets better with time the more I understand how important this principle of meeting a person eye to eye really is. I didn't think I'd have learned that lesson in the Goofy movie, but I am really thankful that I did. And I'm happy I get to share this song with y'all as a result. So, we're gonna stay in the 90s, we're gonna move it further in the decade a little bit. And next up, we have Freedom. by Robert Miles, featuring Kathy Sledge of Sister Sledge fame on chorus, I mean on lyrics. And it's actually a remix of that. It's my favorite version of the song. Naj, you can let it play. And when I think of this song, I think of the idea of affirmations. I think that's become something a lot more common in today's society when everybody's working through a lot of mental health related things or just trying to build some self-empowerment, that having a powerful message to return to, something like an incantation that you can say to yourself or say to other people, that really sort of reclaims your power. And the lyrics of the song do that incredibly well. Builds up for a little bit, but I'll have it run up and through the chorus. And yeah, let me know what you guys think. So these are some late 90s incantation vibes for you. So the message is straightforward, but really empowering. This idea of that your whole life has been a chase for things that really make sense to you when you think about who you are as a person. Deep down, you know in your soul that love is in control. And then also that thing we said earlier about reclaiming power. If only you could find the angel within, it's time to have faith in your wings. Like, it's just, this is an anthem, really. I think that's the best word for this song. An anthem for reclaiming your freedom, for being guided by love, and for not only that, for wanting the same for other people. As it says at the bottom of the chorus, in the new day that's coming, freedom for all is our destiny. Is that on top of like this late 80s, 90s house beat? So like if you need good, let me wake up and clean my whole house music on a good Saturday or Sunday morning, it is a solid 8 minutes of incredible production and some really powerful vocals. Like Kathy put her foot in some vocals when she wants to. Could we take it back maybe about a minute? I think I may have blabbed over the second verse. And the rhyme scheme in the second verse is really similar to the first verse. And the second verse responds upon the message from the first verse. It's encouraging people to take that journey. Every stone that I left unturned came back to haunt me. Every fall, every finger burned was a step on the road to the truth. And it just is encouraging us to have these human experiences within our own life, to explore these little mysteries, because they'll lead us back to ourselves. And once we're back to ourselves, we're better suited for understanding other people. I get chills every time I read that line, that there's a step on the road to the truth, that I am you in my soul. You are not alone. Goosebumps. Yeah, like that's some poetry for real. Or even the fact that the chorus is like a perfect refrain that plugs in perfectly to both verses and pre-choruses. I see a little hand wave icon from you, Camille.
Oh yeah, but you answered it. I was just contemplating like the possible meanings of that verse too, but I think in relationship to the chorus, that makes sense. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That being the answer to verse two.
Because what sets a person free is going, well, really, to flip the language on itself, the opposite of freedom is whatever makes a person feel restrained, whether that's a lack of control or power or flexibility in their personal life, in their professional life, in their relationships. And I love how specific yet vague the song is in that regard. It's acknowledging that people may have their own hangups, but so long as they're willing to go through the pursuit of figuring out these little mysteries in their life, they can set themselves free. And that's the key to setting everybody else free too. In the song, here's like the last loop of the chorus. You hear like the vocals kind of elevated a bit. She takes it up a pitch. And to me, that always feels like at this point in the song, she's freed everybody and they're singing together. So another personal favorite is up next. We're going to stay in a bit of a house music bag. So this is a song. Actually, I think this was my most played song on Spotify of this past year, which is random because it's from this American music group who calls themselves Naked Music. I promise the music is safe. Because the idea of Naked Music is more that it's music that is stripped down from a writing sense, and it encourages that personal intimacy. That line in the chorus, the "you are like flowers to the sun inside my heart" is like, that's like, imagine the imagery of that. And just the idea that this person's love that they're offering to their partner here is helping them grow into what they really are. You are like flowers to the sun inside my heart. get out of here. When you asked me to do this and we were talking about like songs that work as poetry, this is the first song that came to mind. But also, as I'm sure you guys are noticing from listening to it, the way that they design the lyrics, it's again really similar to haiku in like the syllable count. Dreams that we could share. Even that line, hope is just the road and it's time to take it home. Hope is a way to go through life and it'll lead you to a place that feels like home. You are like flowers to the sun inside my heart. Together we can grow if we're willing to give the love a try. This time around, beautiful songwriting. Like, I absolutely adore this drawing. And it's got, if you haven't listened to a bunch of music from the Naked Music Group, this is sort of their signature sound. It's kind of sultry, it's really passionate. Normally it'll have a woman vocalist hitting some crazy notes, some really poetic songwriting, and this kind of like ambient pop that makes it wonderful to put on the loop and repeat. Yeah.
Question about like, so after you're done with this, is it possible that like people are allowed to like request music or discuss like a song that like we think is particularly significant with regard to like poetry or lyricism?
Definitely, yeah. I'm all okay for that.
I'm gonna let you finish.
I'm gonna let you finish, but I got one of the best songs of all time is what she's telling us.
Basically, exactly.
I think what's up next is One Witch by Aquanote. Aquanote's another one of the artists in the Naked Music Recordings label. And so the One Wish, I guess I wouldn't say it's as sophisticated in terms of like having like one really like crazy line. But what I love about One Wish is that it takes a really simple poetry prompt of wishful thinking or even reusing a phrase over and over in a poem. And it just plays out into a really sweet song. Also, for anyone who missed the poetry workshop, these are normally the kind of vibes that we were giving, so please join us next time we have them going. But here's the message. So from then on in the song, she uses the wish in multiple different ways, and that's just the way that the song is written. I wish I had a way to stay curious instead of working hard, being too serious. It's a beautiful song that I think anybody can relate to, and kind of, I think when I listen to it, it makes me reframe like my personal desires and my values. Like if I actually could wish for something, not just fully selfishly, but like for the world, to make myself a better contribution to the world, I think of things like this, and I have this song to thank for just really getting my mind in that place to consider what it means to be really wishful, you know? To make our dreams come true. I wish everybody
wish I had.
Can I see a hand raised for this song? So the thing about these songs, this one and the one before, both being made from the same label of music, they're infectious on a musical level, but because there is that sweetness and that presence and that vulnerability to the songwriting, I find that I always get these stuck in my head because of just how good the message is. This is one that always puts me in a good place. Like, it's hard not to be. You got the freaking harmonies on both sides, the guitar, a little flute in the background. Some good stuff. So this next one's an interesting case. This is a song that I catch myself singing all the time. But it's actually an English cover of a song originally written in Japanese. If you are hip to the culture, you've probably seen an anime series by the name of Samurai Champloo. It has this classic ending theme song that'll just lull you to sleep. It's literally so beautiful. And Sapphire is a Black American music artist who does covers of these songs so that people can enjoy them in a language that they understand thoroughly. And so the song Shiki no Uta literally translates to the Song of Four Seasons. And the song is roughly about a person missing somebody and longing to see them as the different seasons of the year pass by. We got the Wikipedia article in there. Appreciate you. Gotta keep the people educated. The original song has like such a wonderful cadence to the way that the words come together. It's also similarly very bouncy to the way I like to write my poems. So it was one that I had had stuck in my head for years anyways, but Sapphire comes along with these wonderful rendition of the lyrics, and I'm always geeked when this comes on because I can sing along to it. All our happiness will only dream. So darling, stay with me, as I'm missing on the same project. In the darkest times, you would always find the way. So darling, what you say? Welcoming spring. Summer's bringing. Just wishing you were here this autumn night. Should winter arrive, I'll still be waiting for a sign. On the dot, here we are living free. I wish tonight would go on for eternity. Will we ever meet again? Tell me that it ain't the end. My tears start to flow. Oh, baby, please don't go. So give credit to both the original songwriters for the way that the medley was composed, and give Major props to Sapphire for not only getting a translation that fits the message of the original song, but also matches it beat for beat. It's really wonderful writing. Bring the chorus right back. So baby, let's dance all throughout the springtime. And then they end on the same notes that the song opens up on. All our happiness will only be a dream. So darling, won't you stay with me? Cause all the seasons are the same without you. In the darkest times, you'd always light the way. So darling, won't you stay? It is such a vibe. You don't even catch how sad of a song this is. Like, the lyrics are high-key heartbreaking, but comes together and it's so catchy. She actually added a kind of like, I don't want to say Afrobeat, but a bit of like more percussive flair than the original song in her cover. And yeah, fun to listen to literally all year round in any season, as the song implies.
I was gonna say, when you said it, you don't realize how sad it is. I just went like on this whole deep dive again of Hey Ya by Outkast. I mean, I already, we all know like what the song means at this point, but like every time I dive into it, like it's even better. Like, I don't know, that's a masterpiece. I love that song. I think that's a good example of that.
If we do this again, we're definitely putting that in here. Well, when we do this again, because this is actually a lot of fun. So, does anybody know what the Wilhelm scream is? I know that our guy in the chair with the music knows what it is. Hey, Nas, can we get a Wilhelm scream real quick? You got it on YouTube or something? Everybody knows what it is. Not everybody knows what it is. I don't know about my dreams. So the Wilhelm scream is the stock screaming sound effect that they play in movies and TV shows and cartoons, and they've been using it for years. It's like if somebody falls off a cliff or something comedically, they'll make this sound that's called the Wilhelm scream. And it's been in use since the 50s, I think. I don't know about my love. Everybody's pulling it up. See, everybody knows what the Wilhelm scream is.
Wait, but why is it called Wilhelm? Like, who was it named after?
I don't know who Wilhelm is, right? Okay. But I know that I laughed at the name of this song in like a, oh, that's really cute kind of way once I connected the dots. Because the song is about a person who has fallen in love or is falling so fast that everything else in life kind of doesn't really worry or concern them as much. I don't know about my dreams. I don't know about my dreaming anymore. All that I know is I'm falling, 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 helplessly, comedically falling like the Wilhelm scream. Maybe it's because like I'm a big TV and movie person, or maybe it's because I just have a really corny sense of humor. I think that device as the title for this song is so beautiful.
Absolutely. I think that's super poetic. It's an insider a little bit, because I don't think too many people know what a Wilhelm scream is, but like once you know, it's like, okay, it gives it new meaning for sure.
Because once you hear it, you're like, okay, then what's the song about? And the person says they're falling. And you're like, oh, wow, they're really falling. If you make it a Wilhelm scream, like, you're in love. And so the song is more or less a repeat of these hooks. I don't know about my dreams. I don't know about my love. And I have it on my sunset playlist. Because this is one of them songs you listen to on like a ride back home after whatever you've been doing during the day. And it's just really soothing. If I'm not mistaken, James Blake did the original, but I discovered this song by the band, The Bamboos. They're wonderful. And sidebar, they're an example of like how New Zealand and Australians be cooking Americans when it comes to American music. Like, whether it's big band jazz or like just conventional pop music or anything of that variety, they be killing it. I didn't know these guys were from New Zealand, so I looked it up. But this is one of them songs that I guess would be like in a Hallmark commercial over here or something.
Mm-hmm. Hiatus Coyote, aren't they from New Zealand?
Hiatus Coyote,
yeah.
Kimbra, amazing. Like they
amazing.
Yeah. I don't know about my dreams. Do you know how this would happen at a poetry reading? Is that a person would get up and just read the poem, like they'd read these lyrics, and then after they're done reading it, they'll say, the poem's called The Wilhelm Scream, and then the three people in the crowd that get the reference would laugh at it. Again, if you're falling that fast, yeah, you might as well lean into it, because at that point, clearly ain't nothing going to catch you. This is a song from Tennis. Tennis is a two-member band of husband and wife. They're from Denver, Colorado, if I'm not mistaken. And I can best describe it as music made by people that grew up listening to Fleetwood Mac. Chorus of this song is one that I sing it to myself all the time. Like, it's really, really succinct and really devour to empower, and just the way that she flips the first line on itself. So instead of being devoured by the loneliness they feel in that love, they let the fact that they have that love to themselves be the thing that builds them back up. So the song itself isn't that long. Doesn't have a ton of words to it, but that hook, that chorus, is definitely one that sticks with me, and I imagine is an earworm for a bunch of other people too. If I'm not mistaken, the song is written about her mother, the singer's mother, and her marriage to her father. And I believe her mother is a seamstress, and that's why the song is called Needle in the Knife. Yeah. Even that, like, if you just took that and made it a four-line haiku, like, that's... Hey! I'm glad you enjoyed. Please let me know if you find a new favorite song. I just like talking about music, and not a lot of people know these songs necessarily, so I'd love to have somebody to talk to about them. But have a good rest of your night. Thanks for coming by. Let's see, what do we have up next? Oh, wow, how did I forget to make a slide for this? So this is actually, if I had to pick my favorite song, I don't have it listed here because, of course, I would forget my favorite song, but it's called A Song for Two. And it's a duet, the entire thing. And so each lines are written kind of like a four bar, or each verse is written in kind of a four bar with a woman singing and a man singing, and they start and finish each other's lines. So it's a song that's about the union of love, but is reflected in not only the way it's written, but also the way it's performed. But, the chorus is pure poetry. I also think it's beautiful how, like, they do the whole exchanging of the four bar, who's singing each line, but they sing the chorus together. Beautiful, crazy, inspirational break that is straight out of a 70s movie. You know they were trying to be in a 70s bag, because who pulls up with a xylophone solo? And it works? I hear this song and I just imagine a couple somewhere in like a prairie, and it's just like a sunny day, and they're just like twirling and singing to each other. After they do the chorus for a second time, there's like a bridge, and they sing about just how they are willing to face the future with having each other in the other's life.
Okay,
No one ever cried and take it down. Together we'll face whatever hell the future has to bring. Like, that's not... If it ain't like that, I don't need it, basically. Hand raise.
Yeah. So as I'm looking at this slide that says highlighting lyricism in some of your personal faves, I just remembered. I meant to ask you, and I forgot. I'm going to ask you, what does lyricism mean to you? Like, okay, so especially when it comes to music, lyricism is a hot topic, especially if we're talking about R&B, specifically if we're talking about like hip hop and music genres like that. So what does lyricism mean to you? Good lyricism versus poor lyricism?
Well, I guess the only poor lyricism would be lyricism that is either, I guess, intentionally harmful, because music ultimately is a tool for connection. Even if it's a sad song or a song about a heavy topic, it has the ability to let us be present with that feeling. So I think anything that's just phony, not saying any names, Drake, anything that's phony, doesn't have any kind of substance or heart to it. Yeah, I guess that'd be the big thing for me. If the music or the lyricism is intentionally harmful or just hollow, it doesn't really have too much love or warmth behind it. If you can't think for it about the lyric and relate it to a human emotion or put yourself into perspective of why a person would be singing or expressing that thing, then that should tell you all you need to know.
Makes sense.
Also, this last song is an instrumental. That I just like to play for the workshop sometimes. So I'm gonna have Nas loop this. If anybody else had any questions or comments about any of the things, that is the last song that I have prepared for you. But if people would like to write, I also had this queued up so people could take this time to be creative for a little bit too. But thanks for listening to a random assortment of a bunch of different songs that I really love and enjoy. And I hope you can see where I'm coming from. And I hope it makes you think about your favorite songs and why you always sing them too.
Absolutely, love this. So like about that requesting a song thing.
Okay, I mean, you can hear us.
Right, so let me think, which one? Because in my mind, okay, so when I think poetry in music, I immediately go to like Hiatus Coyote, right? Just because Napalm, I don't know if Napalm writes her own music. I'm sure she's involved in writing some of it at least, but just extremely powerful words but very short words and very short phrases and verses. I think that's like one of the things that makes poetry to me, is like being able to say like a whole lot in a very, very short amount of writing. So
exactly.
There's one that, I mean, there's several, but like there's one called Homebody. So good. So
I was
good.
Thinking of Molasses.
Molasses is great. But Homebody is one of those that's like, it makes you emotional, but it's like, and it's the music, but the music is almost like taking a back seat, which is why it makes me think of poetry, because like the music is very much just kind of lingering there. Like there's no heavy beats. There's nothing like that. And you absolutely are focused on the lyrics, that's just talking about the idea of home and being at home in your body and taking home with you where you go, you know, that kind of thing. So that one is amazing. And also Bonnie Raitt, I Can't Make You Love Me, I think that's what it's called. You know the song, I think.
Yes.
Okay, yes. That's a good song as well.
You're right on. I'm even now remembering Molasses leads into building a ladder. And just even that notion of building a ladder of love to you. Mm. And I hope that love, you build one too.
Mm-mm.
Like, what? Like, I'm gonna meet you up there. I'm not where I need to be. I need to give you what you need. And maybe you aren't either. But if we build ourselves up, we can get up there and hand in hand, we fly away.
Right. You're saying a lot without saying too much. Love it.
There's actually a song that didn't make the cut because I guess just sonically it was a bit different than everything else I brought today. But it's a song by an indie rock band called The Wombats. And the name of the song is Greek Tragedy. And so throughout it, he's just kind of singing about a relationship that is mostly dysfunctional, but they're more or less putting up an act because they know everybody else is watching it from the outside.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the song, he says, fill up the cheaper seats, here comes the Greek tragedy. And anybody that's familiar with Greek tragedy knows that, well, that's the part where everybody dies.
Yeah.
At the end. And so, like, I could not think of a crazier notion or what the chaotic collision of a bad relationship ending feels like better than Greek tragedy on a theater somewhere. Like, I heard that and I was like, damn, that's some writing right there.
Exactly. I actually, thinking about this now, I have so many. I should have sent you, like, I mean, but then this would have been like 3 hours long. We don't want to do that. But next time.
So what we're doing is we're doing
another
exactly.
one. Exactly.
And we'll get some of Nas's favorites in there too.
Yep.
Or maybe even we could do a thing on the NB socials and ask people, like, what's her song with beautiful lyrics that mean a lot to you personally?
Absolutely, that would be dope. I think we get a lot of responses for that too.
Yeah. We even Michelle left out of here with a couple recommendations.
Yeah.
No one should get in trouble for looking up naked music. You should be safe. Your Google searches should be fine.
My browser history.
Just the name. You should be okay. I was going to say this for anybody who's in here that wouldn't have had me on Instagram, but if we cut this up and put it on Instagram, it won't matter necessarily. But I'm on Instagram at Mr. Starwind, and I'm on Spotify at Starwind Radio. All these songs I shared today, I have regularly in rotation on my multiple Spotify playlists. I create them to fit everyday moods and occasions. So there's one for the morning, one for the sunset, as I mentioned. There's a disco one, there's an outer space one, a beach one. And the whole thing there is that I recognize a lot of people have different bags when it comes to music, and that when people focus specifically on the music that they know from where they're from or where they grew up, it can be kind of exclusionary to anybody who isn't also familiar to it, whether you came from a different country or you just didn't listen to music at that time. So the playlists I put together are always put together from my experience, which was the experience of a person who was kind of getting everything in bits and pieces. So I like to think of it as a neutral space where you could throw any of those things on shuffle and find something that's your new favorite song.
Great.
That's it. I appreciate you both. This was a lot of fun.
Yes, I love this. I love this. This was dope. Okay.
Poetry and Music 2024. Coming
Absolutely.
soon.
Absolutely.